Hello and welcome to another video from Global Custodian. Today I'm pleased to be joined by Boon Hiong-Chan, Global Head of Securities Market and Technology Advocacy at Deutsche Bank. Boon, good to be speaking with you again today.
John, it's really good to be speaking with you too.
Yeah, we're going to be digging into digital assets, central bank digital currencies, regulatory developments, and the impact on custody and tokenization. And like I said, I think there's a lot of new things to bring up today. But if I could start with, we've kind of moved on from those days of people thinking Bitcoin bad, blockchain good, and tokenized financial instruments have now emerged. Would you say there are any differences between crypto native digital assets and tokenized assets for any differences that participants need to understand?
Like you say, the space have really moved on from the days of, you know, Bitcoin bad, blockchain is good. And then we actually see that, you know, increasingly digital bond, right, is being issued. But, you know, interestingly for this question, I think, you know, if we can explore from the technology view, because there are actually a lot of differences, but a technology view could actually drive some of the differences in, for example, legal, regulatory risks, and even adoption. Crypto tends to bring to mind is permissionless, right? So no KYC, but this is no longer true. You can actually have crypto with KYC or permission, crypto or permission DeFi these days. So it's exemplified by Aave Arc with Fireblocks. Digital asset or digital bond tends to bring to mind as well that, you know, it can be only issued on a private or permission blockchain, but this is also no longer true. A digital bond can be issued on a public blockchain. So for example, like, you know, the experiment that we have done internally in here in Deutsche Bank, and of course, right, those reported of our peers in the industry like BNP Paribas and Societe Generale, who has actually issued bonds on the public blockchain. So increasingly, I think for participants, it's more important to actually look at the public blockchain or the private network. Because depending on which is used, there are significant differences. Let me just quickly go into some of these differences. In the private network, for example, right, you know, you have the relative certainty of regulations. However, right, you also run the risk of fragmentation. For example, if I have a digital bond issued on one private network, then what happens if another bond is issued on another private network? So if you can imagine, right, do we then need to be assessing and maintaining access to all the different islands of liquidity in this private network space? So, you know, that's, you know, something to be considered. On the public blockchain, of course, right, there's always this concern about KYC and AML. However, what you gain is actually an immediate big market, accessibility, liquidity. So therefore, right, you know, if you're actually talking then about public blockchain, things to focus for the participants would include, for example, smart contracts. If the smart contracts used in order to issue the digital asset, right, you know, and if there is any logical error in the smart contract, but what about consensus mechanism that, you know, impacts directly the settlement finality from probability based to immediate certainty? So, you know, we hear of things like proof of work, which is dominated by Bitcoin these days, you know, but increasingly proof of stake, delegated proof of stake, and even proof of authority. And, you know, in some other spaces, right, in the payment space, we hear of things like federated Byzantine fault tolerance. So these are all consensus mechanisms that determines the settlement finality type. Therefore, you know, from a participant perspective, look into the type of ledger that's being used, public blockchain or private network, for a sense of its pros and cons, which will drive the differences that will be reflected in legal contract, regulatory consideration, as well as adoption and ecosystem.
Yeah, great. Thanks for that answer. And if I think of, you know, native digital assets and tokenized assets as two pillars under that digital assets umbrella, the third one for me is often central bank digital currencies. So we can just come on to that area. Capital market use cases of CBDCs are sometimes overshadowed by the retail discussions. What do you see as the pros and cons of capital markets CBDC use?
We agree with you, John, that, you know, most of our focus is on a retail CBDC as a payment mechanism. But we also believe that, you know, a capital market CBDC would be a next phase of evolution and investigation. So, you know, we have seen, for example, in France. let's just assume that, you know, a capital market CBDC is either tokenized based or asset account based. And then at the same time, right, it's programmable and it's able to carry information payload. So one of the pros here, or probably the potential here, is that can it be used then, right, for mutualizing the AML and sanctions filtering activity that today every bank does, but, you know, we do it from our own institutional view. With a CBDC that's operated by the central bank and together in the collaboration with the industry, can we actually mutualize this so that, you know, the patterns that one organization can't see can be more visible when you actually see it from a totality, from, you know, a top-down perspective. This actually can save costs and increase efficiency. So I think this will be one of the potential advantages of a capital market CBDC. The next one is actually not as much a pro or cons, but an observation, right, an anticipation that with a capital market CBDC, because of its speed, and because, right, you know, the way it could be designed and implemented, market structure can change. So, for example, today for DVP, you have the securities platform and then you have the cash platform. But with CBDC, potentially you could have one unified platform to handle both and therefore, right, achieve true DVP. But then what does it mean then for market participants' roles, for example, if this changes? So this, you know, remains to be seen. And finally, you know, from another consideration is, you know, what would this mean for cross-border investors? So we're talking a lot about, you know, domestic market, but from a cross-border perspective, right, you know, then some of the considerations can include: does the tokenized capital market CBDC, if it's available outside of the country, does it contain metadata that could actually impinge on secrecy, confidentiality, or data privacy considerations? And of course, you know, in order to reduce the latency of this capital market CBDC, if it's deployed overseas, you know, a node may be deployed overseas too, but how do you then protect this node? Is it considered to be a sovereign node? So, you know, all this sets out, I think, you know, this capital market CBDC to be really an exciting topic to explore.
The final question I have for you, which you know, leads on nicely as well, and this is one of my favorite conversation topics at the moment. Do you see digital asset custody and mainstream custody converging or diverging?
The digital asset custodian and the traditional custodian are starting from the same starting point, but over time we should actually see some divergence. What doesn't change is actually, right, you know, their role to protect assets and to look after investors' interests. But from that point onwards, the digital asset custodian role, right, can diverge from the traditional asset custodian. For example, in the digital asset space, the custodian can be a standalone custodian, like, you know, the traditional custodian sub-custodian structure, or it can be a part of a prime brokerage type model that supports a crypto hedge fund as well as brokers to navigate through the market structure inefficiencies, like, you know, optimizing collaterals. It could be supporting asset managers, you know, who would be using, right, you know, the fractionalization capability of crypto together with the programmability to create new investment products. A digital asset custodian could also play the role of a tokenizer, or, you know, a facilitator of interoperability, you know, when investors invest into assets using that was created using a different tech stack from another digital asset. And finally, of course, a digital asset custodian could possibly be a node validator too, if that node, right, you know, plays a part in confirming settlement finality. Mm-hmm. So I'll say that, you know, both roles are starting from same position, but, you know, it could diverge.
That's really interesting. Well, I think we've covered a lot of bases here and been touched on a bit of everything and the most important matters in this space. But yeah, I guess a lot will happen in the next year or so. So maybe we should check in again same time next year, Boon.
Yeah.
Call it an annual update. Well, thanks very much for your thoughts today. I really appreciate it.
No, thank you very much for your time, John. Really appreciate it too.